Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2023. And our first agenda item this morning is the consideration of continued petitions. And the first of those is petition number 1958 to extend aftercare for previously looked after young people and remove the continuing care age gap. This petition was lodged by Jasmine Kasiah Pilling on behalf of Who Cares Scotland. And I'm delighted to see Jasmine, who gave evidence at a previous session of the committee, is with us in the gallery today. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to extend aftercare provision in Scotland to previously looked after young people who left care before their 16th birthday on the basis of individual need, to extend continuing care throughout care experienced people's lives on the basis of individual need, and to ensure care experienced people are able to enjoy lifelong rights and achieve equality with non-care experienced people. This includes ensuring that the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child and the findings of the Promise are fully implemented in Scotland. And it was back in May when we did last consider the petition, and so this morning, following that earlier session, I'm delighted to be able to welcome Natalie Dodden, MSP, the Scottish Government's Care Experience Policy Manager, Sarah Corbett, and the Unit Head for a Good Childhood, Cara Cooper. Welcome to you all. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. And as I said earlier, we have the petitioner with us in the gallery too. And Minister, I understand you'd just like to say a few words in opening before we move to questions. So I'm delighted to do that. So over to you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning all. I'm very grateful to the committee for inviting me along to give evidence this morning, and I really welcome the opportunity to discuss the proposals in petition PE1958 to extend aftercare for previously looked after young people and to remove the continuing care age gap. Now, I understand that the committee first discussed this petition on the 31st of May this year, and that members listened in particular to the importance of ensuring that individuals are aware of their rights. I believe that the commencement of the incorporation of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child into Scots law gives us all across the chamber a golden opportunity to continue to promote public awareness and understanding of the rights of the child and the entitlements of those leaving care to the right help and support. Now, listening to the challenges experienced by our young people moving on from care must and will continue to inform our approach to reducing the variation in the support that they receive. Now, 2 weeks ago, it was Care Experience Week, appropriately, given the focus of what the committee heard last time. And no doubt some of what we will discuss today, the theme for this year's events was lifelong rights for care experienced people. Now, the First Minister and I both attended different events where we met with young people with lived experience and some of the practitioners who are working alongside them. I've been really, really moved by many of the meetings and discussions that I've had so far with our care experience community, and equally wholly impressed with their passion and their dedication to help ensure that their experiences can influence positive change for others. During Care Experience Week, the Scottish Thoroughcare and Aftercare Forum, or otherwise known as STAFF, launched its 100 Days of Listening consultation to understand what those with experience of care and the workforce that support them need and want to happen for the promise to be kept. Now, I'm pleased to say that my officials are working in close partnership with staff to take this work forward, and we are actively listening to people with lived experience to understand what it will take to remove the stigma and the barriers faced by our care experienced community so that they can achieve equality with their non-care experienced peers. In our programme for government this year, we committed to launching a public consultation on what the broad package of support for care experienced young people should include to support them into adulthood. And this consultation will be launched in spring 2024 and will build on what we hear through that 100 days of listening. Convener, I really want to reassure the committee today that we are determined to review and to co-design the policies and supports for people with experience of care alongside those with lived experience so that we get it right for all of our young people and that they feel loved, cared for, respected and can flourish into independent adults. We do, however, also recognise the particular financial challenges faced by our care experienced young people at a point where they are moving on to independent adult living. So that is why on the 26th of October, the First Minister announced our plans to consult on a care leaver payment of £2,000 to help young people transitioning from care to independent living. Now, I am acutely aware that our work across government to keep the promise requires a cohesive and a coordinated approach across all of our care services, our health services, our education services, our justice services. And I am extremely grateful to the carers, the workforce, the agencies and the stakeholders who work hard to provide the best environment for our children and young people in care. I also just want to put on the record my admiration and appreciation for the young people themselves, many of whom I've met throughout my time in this role, who continue to share their experiences of care and champion the rights of those with care experience. Finally, I would really just say that I very much welcome the committee's interest in this petition, and I'm happy to answer questions that members may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. Yes, we last considered the petition on the 31st of May when we were reflecting on the evidence that we'd heard in April from the petitioner, also from Who Cares Scotland, CELSIS, the Children and Young People's Commissioner, and the Promise Scotland. And it was, I think, quite a striking round table discussion that we all participated in, or members of the committee at the time participated in. And I think one which certainly persuaded us as a committee of the kind of fundamental kind of decency and drive of Jasmine's petition. So I just think you've answered this question, but I would just like to open up by asking you for a very sort of clear assertion of where in its sense of priority the government sits the extending of the eligibility for continuing care and aftercare through legislation.
So as I said in my opening remarks, I think that the care that we receive is inconsistent. And I think that we need to work on that. I think what is really, really important is that, as I say, that we are listening to what young people and care experienced people need. Now, in terms of aftercare, I just want to be very clear that that refers to the advice, the guidance and the assistance that is provided to care leavers. And this can include, but is not restricted to, securing accommodation, education and employment opportunities and financial support. And as I've said, we understand that there are inconsistencies there. So, for example, when young people leave care before their 16th birthday, they don't always benefit from smooth and well-supported transitions, which can leave them less well-prepared for adulthood than their peers. It also means that they have no legal entitlement to that aftercare support that would be available to them if they had left care after their 16th birthday. So, as I said, the promise is made clear that lifelong advocacy is required for people with care experience to realise their rights and to thrive in life and have a well-supported transition into adulthood. As I said, I've heard loud and clear throughout my time in this role that care experience stays with you for life, and that support needs to be available for people to tap into at key points in their life. So it's absolutely a priority to get it right for care experienced people. As I've referred to, the staff 100 days of listening and the consultation that we'll be embarking on in 2024, we'll take the work in from that and look to expand that further.
And I should, of course, say that if Cara Cooper or Sarah Corbett wish to come in, let me know, or if the Minister wants to invite them to come in, then that would be helpful too. I think I follow what you're saying, and that is through the listening and the consultation, you are exploring ways in which this priority could be realised or delivered. That may or may not be through legislation. Is that kind of where we're at? I'm just trying to understand if you see a legislative role in all of this, or if you feel that through the work that you're doing, there may be another route to achieve the outcome.
I'd maybe bring officials in on the point as to whether it would have to be a legislative route. I could see other options because we already provide that guidance anyway. We already expect that for care experienced people anyway of that certain age group. But in terms of any legislative changes, there will be opportunity within our promise bill that we have agreed will be going through Parliament within this parliamentary session. So we expect to introduce that next year, towards the end of next year, given plenty of time for a lot of different various pieces of work that are going on to kind of see what would be included within that bill. However, as I say, in terms of that specific ask, whether that would have to be legislative or not, I'll perhaps hand over to officials.
Sure, absolutely. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. So as the Minister's explained, we are currently exploring what avenues we need to take forward to improve the broadest package of support we provide for our young people with experience of care. In terms of your question, particularly around legislation, and our commitment to keep the promise, we do have the forthcoming promise bill, which is slated for 2025. And that's where we would be able to take forward any necessary legislative changes that are required. So through the work that the Minister has already referenced in terms of our partnership with staff, the 100 Days of Listening, which is just one part of how we are engaging with the broadest, all of our stakeholders, and for us to triangulate between the voices of our young people with lived experience, as well as the workforce who deliver that, and with our partners. And then when we work towards the public consultation, which will be launched in spring, which will encompass, it will be a really broad ranging consultation to make sure that we're opening up as widely as possible on what does the current landscape look like and what changes do we need to make in order to effect the transformational change and for us to keep the promise. So the Promise Bill would be our most appropriate legislative vehicle. And if we do need to make legislative changes, if there is policy that needs to be updated or we need a statutory footing, then that's where we would be able to consider that and take that forward.
Okay, thank you. David Charnes.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to panel members. Minister, around Section 66 of the Children and Young People's Act 2014, is the Scottish Government considering to amend it to remove the need for a young person to still be in care on their 16th birthday to access support and remove the age limit of 26 for accessing aftercare? And apologies.
That's fine. Thank you. Sorry, were you finished yet?
Yes.
Yeah, sorry, I wasn't
sorry,
sure.
Sorry, apologies for that.
No, not at all, not at all. So the aim of continuing care is to provide young people with a more graduated transition out of care, reducing the risk of multiple simultaneous disruptions occurring within their lives whilst trying to maintain supportive relationships around them. Now, aftercare, sorry, I'm just trying to make that distinction here. So aftercare refers to the advice, the guidance and the assistance provided to care leavers, as I've sort of alluded to in my previous question. And as I said, we do understand that there are inconsistencies there. So the promise has made very clear that lifelong advocacy is required for people with that care experience. And as I say, we've heard loud and clear the calls from the care experience community. I kind of feel like I'm repeating myself here, but I just really want to make it clear that we are absolutely determined to review and co-design the policies and supports and, if necessary, legislate for people with experience of care alongside those with lived experience and with the practitioners who work alongside them. And again, that's just really so that we can ensure that we get it absolutely right for those people. So yes, in response to your question, we would absolutely consider that, but that's something that, as I say, will be worked through once we have the further kind of information from that 100 days of listening and the further information from the consultation. So anything will, as I say, these measures will be considered if we think that that's right for children and young people, but just want to emphasise that we are listening to the voices of the care experienced and those organisations who are leading that work.
Thank you for that, Minister. I'm probably going to get the same answer for this question as well. But will the Scottish Government consider amending regulations to increase eligibility for continued care beyond 21 years of age.
So, again, this refers to... obviously, I gave the distinction of continuing care in response to my previous answer. And I think, again, it's certainly something that can be considered. There might be difficulties with that in terms of somebody being placed in their place of care past that age of 21, because obviously they're getting into adulthood at that point. So again, it's certainly something that would be considered, but I think the focus at the moment is on providing that aftercare and that continuing support through care experience people's lives.
OK, I'm going to go to Maurice Golden next, who's got a question that I think I've heard two answers to, actually, already. So I'm going to see if he can drill down and get the definitive one. Maurice Golden.
Thanks. So I think just to recap, we have a consultation on the Promise Bill by the end of 24, with the bill set to be introduced in 25. Please clarify if that's not the case. And if it is, can you tell us about the kind of key themes that you plan on consulting on as part of the Promise Bill?
So in terms of the consultation, I would probably, I'll maybe hand over to officials in a wee second in terms of, because we've not obviously finished kind of designing that consultation yet. Keeping the Promise Bill slightly separate to that, it's kind of wholly focused around the Keeping the Promise implementation plan. Obviously, that sets out visions for 2030 when we will have delivered the promise. And there are 14 top-level actions within that and around 80 recommendations or actions on top of that as well, which cut across all parts of government. And what I would say is there has been a much higher focus, certainly within my role anyway, my time in this role, of managing that cross-portfolio work with the promise. We're very switched on that this cuts across various different ministerial portfolios. Obviously, we have our cabinet subcommittee on the promise. There's real evidence of us working together to try and achieve these aims. So actions within the promise implementation plan, which aim to reduce those poor outcomes, are kind of circled around poverty, around homelessness, poor health, which often includes mental health, offending, school exclusion, educational attainment, and low employability. So there are, as I say, there are so many different aspects to this, and many of these will be considered in relation to the consultation, and then dependent on what requires legislative change will be put forward in within the Promise Bill. I'll perhaps hand over to Cara.
Chair. Yeah. So thank you for that. Just to clarify, the consultation that we are discussing this morning is our PFG commitment, and that's on the support that is available for young people as they transition out of care into adulthood. So it's very closely linked to how we keep the promise. So I hope that's a helpful clarification. In terms of that consultation, we are still in the process of designing that, and it will be informed by our ongoing engagement with all of our stakeholders, particularly our young people with experience of care, the workforce, and indeed our other stakeholders as well. That will look at the broadest package of support that's in place for young people with experience of care. Okay, so what we'll be doing is looking at what the current landscape is, both on a policy and a legislative basis, and really listening and doing that analysis of what's working well, what is not working well, and for us to look carefully at what the tangible changes need and must be to improve the consistency of care for our young people, as well as to improve life chances and outcomes. So we hear loud and clear that there are things are not working well. The promise tells us that, the independent care review tells us that. This is about us drilling down into a much more a kind of more granular level and to effect the real change that we need to take and make. Within that, we will likely be considering the definition of care experience as well. So committee members may be aware that we currently have a legal definition of care leaver, but we don't actually have a consistently used definition of care experience across the country. And we recognise that that's a challenge and something that we need to address. In the promise, at the moment, it uses what we call the St Andrews definition of care experience. But for us, it's really important that we get this right, that we have a a universally understood and used definition in order that young people realise their fullest rights and that they have that opportunity to access the right support at the right time to improve outcomes and life chances. As the Minister's already kind of touched on as well, there is work ongoing with the Promise Scotland just now around lifelong advocacy, which is very much the theme of this petition. From our perspective, it's about getting the right support at the right time for right people, regardless of whether you left care before your 16th birthday or that you might need some kind of support beyond 26, which is roughly the age limits, but the parameters that sit around continuing care and aftercare just now. So we will be considering all of that within the consultation in the spring. It will also be informed by information we get from the current consultation we have live, which is for the care leaver payment, which the Minister referred to in her opening remarks. And that was the payment that First Minister announced during Care Experience Week. It's a PFG commitment as well, and that's about one part of the broadest package of support we have in place to support young people as they leave care and move into independent adult living. That consultation is due to close in January, so we'll be able to use the information that we synthesise from there to help us inform and design the consultation. As the Minister's already said, we are absolutely committed to working alongside our young people as well as our broadest range of stakeholders to make sure that we get the questions right in the consultation. So it won't just be a case of my team designing the consultation and that it goes out. It will go through rigorous conversations, robust dialogue with a range of stakeholders to ensure that we're framing the questions in the right way so that we get the best possible sources of information that tell us how we design the policy and improve the landscape.
Thanks, and you answered another question on updating definitions, so that was very helpful. But the Minister mentioned educational attainment, and I just wonder if the Minister's comfortable with current educational attendance.
So I don't have those figures in front of me, but what I would say is there's a lot of good work going on the ground to improve things. I've been to several visits where we've had virtual schools, different setups for learning to try and encourage or assist care experience people who might be finding it difficult to attend school for whatever reason. So as I say, there are some really, really good there's some really good evidence of really good things happening on the ground through the Promise and in terms of improving that. And as I say, I would hope that would make an impact on those figures going forward. And again, all with the kind of main aim of improving the lives for care experienced young people. So in terms of expanding on the figures, I would maybe bring officials in for that.
Thank you for that. In terms of the educational outcomes that we saw in 2021, we see that there is a narrowing of the gap on overall educational outcomes for our children and young people with experience of care, but we do understand there is more work to be done there. As the Minister's mentioned, there are the virtual school head teacher networks, which is where we bring head teachers together to really look deeply at where there are challenges in terms of attendance, in terms of attainment for young people at school. We also have things in place such as the Care Experience Children and Young People Fund, which is money that goes directly to local authorities to help them target support and resources where they feel it is best used and most needed to support young people with experience of care. And that actually covers young people right through until they're 26 as well. But we do recognise that whilst the gap is closing in terms of educational outcomes, there is work to do. And we also recognise the work to be done. And there is some good work going on to support young people with care experience to remain in school and to avoid exclusions where possible for care experienced young people.
Thanks for that. And it would be useful perhaps to share with the committee the data around that you hold, ideally broken down by local authority, if that's possible. Quickly, Minister, are you confident that local authorities have both the facilities and the staffing resources to provide that enhanced care package?
Absolutely. I think as I've already referred to some of the visits I've been on, and there is some really fantastic work going on across local authorities. And what I would say is local authorities are best placed to understand what is needed in their area. So as I've already alluded to, the promise covers so many different aspects, so many different kind of policy areas. And I think local authorities, as I say, have been very good at understanding what is needed in their area and sort of taking action on that. So, as I say, in terms of local authorities and visits that I've been to, I've seen a lot of really, really positive work going on, and it's perhaps just about expanding that across. And obviously there are capacity issues around that. Now, in terms of social work, I appreciate that there has been a real increase in the demand and the complexity of work undertaken by the workforce. And I appreciate the recruitment and retention challenges that are ongoing with social work at the moment. What I would say, although local authorities are responsible for planning their workforce and ensuring they have the appropriate levels of staff, we do understand the issues facing the sector and that kind of increase in demand. So there are a number of different things that are being actioned to try and improve things in those ways. So there's a joint working group has been established with COSLA to address the immediate issues affecting the workforce. You'll be aware of the proposals for the National Care Service, and within that, the establishment of a national social work agency, which would support and invest in the profession. However, I appreciate that that's not going to help immediately. That's more a kind of longer term issue. So, as I say, we've got that joint working group set up with COSLA. Also, a national approach to workforce planning, which will hopefully help to achieve the kind of optimal future workforce capacity. And the Short Life Working Group has been created to oversee the development of that and to produce up-to-date data on social work vacancies and the demand for the services. And this will hopefully allow us to facilitate planning and resource allocation at a national level to meet that increase in expected demand. As well as that, a workforce improvement plan has also been developed to address the acute recruitment and retention challenges. That also includes workforce planning and workforce vacancy data. And throughout all this, we are working collaboratively with COSLA, with social work, with the various different agencies that are involved in this. Because, as I say, we know that sector is hugely valued, especially in terms of a lot of the government's aims and priorities. And that's something that we are absolutely switched on to and absolutely trying to improve.
Thanks, Minister. It'd be useful for that data on staff retention and recruitment, if, again, broken down by local authority, could be shared. But I appreciate the measures that you're seeking to deploy. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Fergus Ewing.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. The petition was lodged on the 6th of September 2022. That's 14 months ago. As at the moment, we don't, Minister, have any written response from you or your predecessor as to the specific asks that the petitioner has made. The asks are to extend aftercare provision in Scotland to previously looked after children who left care before their 16th birthday, and extend continuing care throughout the care experience people's lives on the basis of individual needs. So the crux of this petition is that care should be based on need, not the arbitrary occurrence of dates of birth or attaining the age. Now, if, as I understand it, I mean, that your plan is to introduce this bill in 24-25, then it's not going to become law until 25. It might not come into force until sometime after that, typically 2026 or later. That would mean that about 4 years have elapsed between the time when the petitioner raised her plea to this Parliament, which our duty is to interrogate, and the occurrence of any potential response. So can I ask, given that obvious problem, what the Scottish, two questions really, but The first is what the Scottish Government can do now to end the practice of young people being taken off compulsory supervision orders ahead of their 16th birthday. This is a problem that Who Cares Scotland have given us some worrying examples of in practice. And with respect, whilst your good intentions are admirable and absolutely clear, what I think the petitioner wants is concrete actions.
And I completely appreciate that. I've already talked about those discrepancies that the member has mentioned, and I think the petition is very good for highlighting that and highlighting the need for further support. Again, it's not clear whether this would have to be down a legislative route, so obviously if it was, then as the member has referred to, that would be at a later date. However, there could be opportunities to improve guidance around this and change some of the structures around it prior to that. Again, that's going to really be defined by the work that I've already referred to in terms of the consultation and the listening. There are actions that we are taking at the moment. We are updating guidance to simplify language and improve the practice in continuing and aftercare services and provision. We're working very closely with stakeholders, including young people with lived experience, providers and the workforce, to better understand the barriers and what might need to be done to remove them. That Moving On Change programme that I've referred to is actively seeking and facilitating opportunities to further take on board the views of people with experience of care, because as I say, as much as I understand you want us to move quickly, we need to get it right, we need to ensure there is capacity, and we need to ensure that it works for our children and young people. So I believe that might answer your question, but I'm going to bring officials in just in case there's anything that I've not touched on.
No, I think you've covered that there, Minister. In terms of young people being taken off their compulsory supervision orders before their 16th birthday, our guidance is very clear that when young people are coming to that point, that actually our whole approach to improving outcomes for children and young people in Scotland is underpinned by the GIRFEC approach, so getting it right for every child, which really should place the child or young person at the centre of all decisions that are taken and that are made for that young person. So our guidance is very clear that what is best for the child or young person should be placed at the centre when those conversations are being had, when care placements are being reviewed, when we're actually looking towards how that young person will transfer into independent adult living and how we actually support that young person as they grow and develop. So we do have very clear guidance in place at the moment that when those decisions are being taken, that the child's interest should be at the heart of all those decisions that are taken.
I don't think anyone doubts the good intentions of the Minister of the Scottish Government, but the trouble is that the question which I asked hasn't really been answered. The question is what will be done now to deal with this anomaly, and the Minister, the answer you gave, Minister, was that you haven't yet been able to answer clearly the question of whether or not this change can be made without legislation. And it does seem to me that this is a sort of yes or no question. I mean, either legislation is required to make this change or it isn't. If it isn't, and you've suggested that that's something that you're considering, then surely it's your duty to give us clarity on that specific question. Because if the answer is that you don't need to make legal changes, change in the law, then the petitioners will say, well, get on with it, do it now. And in response to Mr. Golden, who quite rightly asked if there was a capacity issue, your first answer was no, there isn't. So if there is the capacity of the local authority to provide the care, then by not acting now, we're allowing this anomaly to remain in place possibly for another 3 or 4 or 5 years. And, you know, with respect, Minister, I appreciate you haven't been in post for a particularly long period of time, and, you know, things take time in government, as I well remember. But nonetheless, your predecessor and yourself have had 14 months now to give an answer to this question. So I think the lack of clarity on the specific question is unfortunate, and I would be most grateful, Convener, if we could get in writing a specific reply, because if legislation is not required, then the petitioners will say, well, just get on with it, do it now. What is the problem? Because I think you've admitted, in effect, that this is an anomaly. I think inconsistency was the word you used. It seems to me completely anomalous. And we have clear evidence that, you know, many young people don't know their rights. And they don't know that by being taken off as CSO, they will lose their rights. I mean, how can they be expected to know? They certainly don't know about the incorporation of the United Nations rights of the child. I mean, why would a 15-year-old have any knowledge about that? So the idea that that has happened in the Scottish Parliament and makes a blind bit of difference to young people knowing their rights seems to me to be completely fallacious. So, you know, I do think the petitioner, it's our job to press for answers for petitioner, and you've had 14 months, we haven't got anything in writing, we haven't got clarity to that question, and I, with respect, Minister, if you're not able to give that clarity today, I would be most grateful if you could write to the committee as soon as possible to answer that simple question, because to me, that then determines whether or not we might want to take this further in various ways, such as having a debate in the Scottish Parliament about it.
Okay, there's a number of points if I could address, please. In terms of young people not knowing their rights, so in my previous response, I referred to updating the guidance, and that's all around trying to ensure that it's more accessible for young people to access. In terms of young people knowing or being aware of their rights under UNCRC, actually what I would say is I've visited a lot of schools and this is something that is on the agenda. Children are talking about their rights. They are aware of their rights. Now, I'm not generalising. There may be schools or areas where that is not always the case, but at least for those that I have visited, for the young people that I have talked to, they are very switched on to this. And that is facilitated by a number of fantastic youth groups and organisations who are working to promote these rights to young people. Currently, out with the government sort of support or aftercare, what I would say is there are a number of advocacy schemes currently in operation. There's a national helpline operated by Who Cares Scotland that's funded by the Scottish Government, the National Children's Hearings Advocacy Scheme, which was enacted in November 2020. So there are ways for care experienced young people to access support. However, as I've said, what this petition and what our work so far, what I've heard so far, is that, as we've said, there are inconsistencies. Change would be required. It is likely it would require legislative change. But again, this will be decided by the consultation and the work that is underway just now. I am more than happy to write back to the committee with further information on that. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Mr. Ewing, that you concluded? Yes, thank you. And Mr. Torrance, is there anything you'd like to come back on?
Just one question, finally. Minister, at the present now, what is the Scottish Government doing to ensure that the provision of Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014 are fully implemented in practice as well as in law?
So guidance for this is absolutely explicit, in our expectation that corporate parents work collaboratively with young people to deliver the integrated support that is required. And the emphasis of that legislation, the regulations and the guidance is on ensuring that the young person is supported to develop in all aspects of their life. Now, as I've said, the guidance is absolutely explicit that the principles of getting it right for every child should be at the core of that pathway assessment, including everyone working together in local areas and across Scotland to improve those outcomes for children. Now, the Children's Services Planning Strategic Leads Network, that is a very long title, I'm surprised I got it all out, is co-chaired with the Scottish Government, and that's a national forum which promotes collaboration, shared learning and improvement activity at national and local level between and across Children's Services Planning Partnerships, the Scottish Government and key stakeholders, and that's all with the aim of strengthening the development, the delivery and the accountability of part of the Children's Services Planning Partnerships and in line with that Act. On behalf of ministers, the Scottish Government undertakes a review of children's services plans every 3 years against criteria set out in statutory guidance, and that's all to support improvements at local and the national level. We then publish a report which summarises areas of strength and development, and I think the most recent published report was in July 2022. Again, we believe that lived experience should be absolutely core to this. So we have involved care experienced young people directly in co-designing and co-producing services so that they can support care leavers effectively. So there is a lot of work underway, scrutiny and sort of regular checks to ensure that is being implemented in practice.
Thank you, Minister. We're listening carefully. Actually, a number of questions have been answered without us having to put them in the comprehensive responses that you've given. So that actually brings us to the end, I think, of the questions that we want to put. Is there anything else you feel we might not have touched on that you'd want to add just before we conclude?
I don't think so. I would just say thank you very much for the opportunity to come along. As I've said, the petition has done a really good job in highlighting some of the inconsistencies, and I look forward to working on that and working towards our shared goals.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you, all of you, for being with us this morning. Members, are you content for us to reflect on the evidence and any further submissions we get and consider it afresh at a subsequent meeting? You are, and on that basis, thank you all, and we'll suspend just briefly to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you. And we're back. And this is now to hear petition number 1859 to retain falconers' rights to practice upland falconry in Scotland, which was lodged by Barry Blyther, who I see is with us again in the gallery, a faithful attendee when his petition's been being considered. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Animals and Wildlife Act 2020 to allow mountain hares to be hunted for the purposes of falconry. And we last considered this petition on the 18th of January. Now, the committee, most of the committee, well, some of the committee, because some of our colleagues have changed hands as we've gone along, but the committee will know that we took evidence from both the petitioner and the Minister for Energy and the Environment. And following those evidence sessions, we had some questions for the Minister, for Police Scotland, the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service, and our friends from Nature Scott. A summary of the issues raised, replies received and additional submissions from the petitioner has been provided by SPICE and is available in the meeting pack. Now, the petition asks for legislation to be changed to allow mountain hares to be hunted for the purpose of falconry, and we've received representations from the petitioner to reiterate that he is asking that falconers be exempt from any risk of prosecution for actively hunting mountain hares. As members will see from the Minister's, I think, disappointing response and recall from the evidence session we held, the Government does not or is not minded, or in fact, no, it just does not intend to make such a change. So I think that's a disappointing position for us to be at this stage. And colleagues, do we have any suggestions as to how we respond and proceed? Mr. Torrens? And Mr. Ewing after that.
Thank you, Convener. Considering the responses that we have had from the Government, I wonder if the committee would be inclined to write to the Minister for Environment and Land Reform recommending that the guidance is produced to clarify how falconers can practice in licensed activities, areas in which there are not a high density of mountain hare and what action to take if a bird accidentally takes a mountain hare. And I wonder if we could write to Police Scotland as well to ask how reports of mountain hare being taken in areas of low density will be recorded and how this information will be shared with Nature Scotland and Falconers. And I wonder if the committee would also consider writing to Nature Scotland to ask how it will monitor reports from Police Scotland and whether it will work to produce maps for falconers to indicate which areas are considered suitable for birds of prey to fly within. And if Nature Scotland intends to produce maps, the committee could ask how it intends to evaluate and update the information in light of reports from Police Scotland.
Now, in the first instance, can I ask if colleagues are content for us to proceed on these lines? But even as we do, I think, Mr Ewing, you feel you would like to make a further suggestion.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I do agree with the recommendations that Sir Torrance has just made. But in addition to that, I do think that we should, in the light of the response, which, as you say, is disappointing, the ministerial response, that we should seek to press this by seeking a parliamentary debate in order to pursue the petition call, which is to urge the Parliament to amend the 2020 Animals and Wildlife Act to allow mountain hares to be hunted for the purposes of falconry. I think a debate in Parliament would allow consideration of what in many ways is a very serious matter. And the first reason I think why a debate would be useful is the circumstances whereby this ban came into force, which was in a Stage 3 amendment, where the petitioner and indeed his fellow falconers had no opportunity to be heard whatsoever. In fact, it seems that nobody thought of them at all, and they didn't have the opportunity to state their case. And the whole point of the Scottish Parliament is that everybody should be able to state their case in the legislative process at the first stage, and that Stage 3 is not supposed to be used for the purposes of introducing brand new material, particularly not legal bans which result in criminal behaviour. So that point of principle is one that I think deserves to be highlighted in Parliament of itself. But turning just briefly to the arguments and the substance, it seems to me that the effect on hares of allowing the continuance of falconry will be de minimis, and Nature Scotland have admitted that the number of hares that would be affected would be minuscule and completely irrelevant to the question of the size of the population. And moreover, I understand from the petitioner, who's kindly given us a great deal of his wisdom and experience, as have others, that it is only certain types of birds of prey, eagles and hawks, I think, that will go for hares. Others won't and can't. But eagles and hawks do need to go for hares, and alternative prey doesn't work. So that suggestion that's been made by some is completely irrelevant. Mm-hmm. And the last thing I would say, and this is really quite sad, that the petitioner has highlighted that the eagle that he has is now self-harming because the eagle can't behave naturally. It's not allowed to. And the petitioner doesn't want to break the law as a law-abiding citizen. So as a result, this bird is suffering because of something that happened in Parliament where his owner and his owner's peers had no opportunity to even state their case. And just the very last thing I would say is that the really disappointing thing in this is that the Scottish Government haven't fessed up to this and said a mistake was made. They've just shrugged off all responsibility whatsoever. So that's perhaps a bit of a rehearsal for the debate, Convener, but nonetheless, it is heartfelt, and I do hope that members might feel that the debate would be... It wouldn't need to be an extended debate, I don't think. It wouldn't need to be 3 hours or anything, but it would allow this matter to be ventilated, and I think there would be considerable interest in colleagues, because I do recall from the debate that there was some disquiet from some of, if I may say so, the older hands that felt that the procedure followed in the Stage 3 of this particular bill was not appropriate.
Thank you, Mr Ewing. I agree. I think there is broader interest in the Parliament. Indeed, there was considerable interest when Stanley visited the precincts of the Parliament. I do think we were disappointed by the evidence underpinning the decision that was made, and also the kind of digging in that we heard in the roundtable evidence that we took, and hoped that, you know, this, the logic and evidence that we'd heard might have led the government to take a different position, but that's not the case. So our colleagues minded that when we next approach the parliamentary authorities in relation to committee debating time, that we seek to have a debate on this issue in the chamber. Yeah. We are. So we will seek to do that and to highlight the issue more generally as a result and see what progress can be made in that way. So we'll take forward the actions. Meantime, I'm not sure when we had a very well-informed debate on mesh not so very long ago, and then we obviously had our committee debate on our report. But I would expect us to have an opportunity to debate again in the chamber in the new year, and we'll see if we can seek to have this as possibly one of two short debates that we would take to the chamber on that occasion. Okay, thank you. We move then to petition number 1867 to establish a new qualification for British Sign Language, lodged by Scott McMillan, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to encourage the Scottish Qualifications Authority, the SQA, to establish a national qualification in British Sign Language, BSL, at SCQF level 2. And as we've done with previous considerations, a BSL interpretation of our discussion will be available on the Parliament's BSL channel following today's meeting. Now, we last considered this petition on the 8th of March, where we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, and we've received a response from the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, which provides details of the engagement and consultation that has taken place to inform the development of the BSL National Plan for 2023 to 2029. Members will have noted in our papers that the Scottish Government consultation on the new BSL National Plan ran over the summer and closed on the 3rd of September 2023. So, given the progress that we've made and the responses we've received, do colleagues have any suggestions? David Torrens.
Convener, considering the responses that we have received, and as you mentioned, the progress we have made, I wonder if a committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that uptake of BSL awards at SCQF level 3 to 6 is increasing. The number of primary schools providing BSL as an L3 language is also increasing, and the Scottish Government do not believe the steps being sought by this petition are required at this time, and have now consulted on the British Sign Language National Plan 2023 to 2029.
Colleagues, are we agreed? So we thank the petitioner for bringing the petition forward. It's open to the petitioner to come back to us again with a fresh petition if they feel that the actions being taken forward by the Scottish Government do not respond or fail to adequately address the issues that have been raised. And at this point, thank them and close the petition. The next petition is petition number 1913, fast tracking of future adult disability applications for people undergoing cancer treatment. And this has been lodged by Wendy Swain, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create a separate department within Social Security Scotland that will fast track future adult disability payments, that's ADPs, for people with a cancer diagnosis whilst they are undergoing treatment. And we considered this last on the 23rd of February and agreed to write to Social Security Scotland. The response from Social Security Scotland really reiterates that the Scottish Government provides a person-centred service and does not prioritise a single condition or type of disability above another. And it states, therefore, that the Scottish Government does not support an additional fast-track procedure specifically for people with cancer, and that there is a fast-track process for people with a terminal illness. Now, in response to questions about processing times, Social Security Scotland has said there are no targets, as no two applications are the same. However, it indicates that the majority of people will receive a decision within 4 months, and that payments are calculated from the date of the application. And I should have said that within the fast-track process for people with a terminal illness, the Scottish Government believes that would accommodate a very significant number of those people with a cancer diagnosis. In the light of the Scottish Government's view that it won't be taking the aim of the petition forward, do colleagues have any suggestions? David Torrens.
I think on the evidence before us, Convener, we have no option but to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has stated that it does not support an additional fast-track route specifically for people with cancer because its approach will not prioritise any single condition over another.
Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I would support that and just add that my understanding from information that the clerks have provided to me this morning that the Scottish Government point out that where an applicant for benefit, disability benefit, is suffering from a terminal illness, that there is a current process which allows that to be taken into account, fast track. And therefore, you know, I hope it's of some comfort to the petitioners that, in fact, what they're asking for is something which the Scottish Government have assured us or says already exists, not only for those who sadly suffer from cancer, but also from other terminal illnesses. So, you know, I hope that that's of some comfort to the petitioner, that the point the petitioner has raised actually is a valid one and has already been recognised as valid and is put in place with a procedure which has due sympathetic regard to people in this desperate situation.
Yes, thank you. And again, I would say to the petitioner, this is something that we should be keep an eye on. They can come back to us again. I mean, I'm conscious of the fact that not all cancers are terminal illnesses, and therefore there will be a number of people who are excluded, but who nonetheless may benefit from the payment at an earlier point in their treatment. So this is something that can come back to us at a later date. But given the Scottish Government's position, there's nothing further, I'm afraid, I feel that we as a committee can do to take forward the aims of the position. So our colleagues content to close on that basis. We are, and I thank the petitioner very much for bringing it to us. Petition number 1918 to improve sex education in schools, which has been lodged by Kate Friedman, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to reform sex education by updating guidance and implementing clear teaching rules, focusing on topics such as menstruation and related illnesses, puberty, LGBT sex, including asexuality, fertility, pornography and other things that are deemed useful. And we last considered this petition again at our meeting on the 18th of January this year, where we agreed to write to Education Scotland. Now, the committee has now received a response to its request for information from Education Scotland. And Education Scotland, they do not monitor or evaluate the implementation of RSHP's teaching resources, noting that it is for local authority officers and schools to monitor and evaluate learning and teaching through their internal policies. However, Education Scotland has delivered webinars for practitioners to guide them in using the website where the teaching resource is held. So in view of the response that we've therefore received from Education Scotland in respect of Scottish Government position, do colleagues have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder, in the light of the evidence that we have, if you could consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders on the basis that RSHP.scotresource, that can we support relationships, sexual health and parenthood lessons, was quality assured and peer-reviewed by partners of educators, health professions and third sector organisation, was informed by feedback over 2018-19 academic year, was tested in draft format with educators, parents and carers before the final content was published in September 2019, and was informed by over 1,000 primary and secondary teachers and piloted in 38 schools in Scotland.
Okay, again, thank you for that, Mr. Torrance. Do colleagues support that?
Yep.
We do. And again, I thank the petitioner, but given the direction of Education Scotland, I think there's nothing more that the committee can do can take forward the aims of the petition, but we thank you very much for bringing it to Parliament. Our next petition is petition number 1934 to develop an educational resource on gender-based violence for all year groups in high school. This has been lodged by Craig Schooler on behalf of Greenfold's High School Rights and Equalities Committee. And the petition calls for the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to work with Education Scotland to develop an educational resource on gender-based violence for all year groups in high school. This resource should educate on the causes of gender-based violence and ensure that young people leave school
with the tools to help create a safer society for women. Now, we last considered this petition on the 22nd of February this year, and we agreed to write to COSLA, Rape Crisis Scotland and the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills. COSLA has provided information on the Mentors and Violence Prevention Programme, noting that 31 local authorities are at the delivery stage, with the final local authority having planned to undertake professional learning earlier this year. Estimates from the National MPV team indicate that over 6,000 sessions have delivered, reaching over 47,800 younger learners. The Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills has indicated that the Gender-Based Violence in Schools Working Group is expected to publish its national framework for schools to help tackle sexual harassment and gender-based violence. And additionally, the Gender Equality Task Force in Education and Learning is working to establish what educational resources already exist, which cover gender inequality. The submission from Rape Crisis Scotland has highlighted ongoing work to address gender-based violence, including its sexual violence prevention workshops in schools. The submission acknowledges the issues raised by the petitioner and also highlights that whilst government cannot prescribe specific measures in the curriculum, there is a duty to ensure educational outcomes are met and that the required systems and resources are in place to assure this. Do members have any comments or suggestions?
Thank you, Convener, once again. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to University of Glasgow seeking further information about the evaluation of equality safe at school as noted in the Rape Crisis submission, including details about scope and evaluation and timescale of when it expects to report. I wonder if we could also write to Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills to ask for an update on the work of Gender Equality Task Force in Education and Learning to establish what educational resources already exist that cover gender inequality. And in writing, the committee could ask for an indication of what the task force's next steps will be when it completes its work.
Thank you. Are members content with those suggestions? Are there any other suggestions? No? Well, we will keep this petition open and we will return to it on receipt of responses to the points that Mr. Torrance has proposed. Petition number 1939, which is to amend the date of birth to allow wider accessibility to the HPV vaccination programme for boys. This was lodged by Suzanne Thornton and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to demonstrate a commitment to health equality for young males born between the 1st of September 1997 and the 1st of September 2006 by allowing them to access the HPV vaccination via the NHS. Considered last by the committee on the 8th of March, where we agreed to seek further clarification from the Scottish Government and the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation, often referred to as the JCVI. Now, the Scottish Government response notes that a one-dose schedule for the HPV vaccination programme was introduced at the beginning of this year, which is intended to increase the number of people completing their vaccination schedule. The response also highlights the policy for teenage immunisation programmes in Scotland is defined by academic year rather than date of birth, the result of this being that any boy that was an S1 for the 2019-20 academic year will be offered the HPV vaccination and will remain eligible up to his 25th birthday. The JCVI response provides clarification on the advice set out in the Green Book guidance on immunisation against infectious disease, with HPV vaccination routinely recommended for all boys and girls at 11 to 14 years of age, with the first and now this being a single dose being offered to young people in S1 in Scotland. And it's also noted that it is up to each of the devolved nations to decide how to operationalise the JCV advice as given. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Torrance?
Thank you, Convener. In light of evidence before us, I wonder if a committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 standing orders on the basis that the JCVI has no plans to review the need for and value of an HPV vaccination catch-up programme for boys due to indirect protection offered through herd immunity, and also the Scottish Government policy is in line with JCVI advice, with the Government having opted to define eligible for teenage vaccinations by academic year in Scotland rather than by date of birth.
Convener,
fine. Thank you. In essence, the response that we've received is suggesting that the particular cohort that wasn't vaccinated will receive a kind of general protection through herd immunity. Fine. Okay, well, Mr. Torrance's suggestion, are colleagues content to proceed on that basis? Yeah, we'll close the petition. We thank the petitioner very much for bringing the issue forward. And clearly we're closing it on the basis of the response that we've received from the GCVI and the Scottish Government. Thank you. The next petition is petition number 1969 to amend the law to fully decriminalise abortion in Scotland, lodged by Gemma Clark. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to bring forward legislation to fully decriminalise abortion services in Scotland and make provisions to ensure abortion services are available up to the 24th week of pregnancy across all parts of Scotland. Now, we previously considered this petition at our meeting on the 22nd of February, where we agreed to seek the views of a number of stakeholder organisations. Following that discussion, we have received responses from the Humanist Society Scotland, the Society for the Protection of Unborn Children, the British Pregnancy Advisory Service, the Catholic Bishops Conference of Scotland, the Christian Education and Research Organisation, Care for Scotland, the Free Church of Scotland, the British Medical Association, and also from the petitioner. And we've also received a submission from Monica Lennon, MSP, who is unable to join us in person today, as well as an update from the Scottish Government, which highlights the commitment in this year's programme for government to review the law on abortion. Now, requests to provide written evidence have also been received from the Scottish Council on Human Bioethics and the Evangelical Alliance. Those in support of the petition suggest that abortion should be treated as a medical rather than criminal matter, and that decriminalisation would bring Scotland in line with international human rights standards. In contrast with those concerns about moves to decriminalise abortion, argue that keeping abortion within criminal law is essential for women's safety, as there must be a way of prosecuting abusive partners who seek to pressure or coerce a woman to abort pregnancy. Responses also argued that the majority of abortions are carried out not on medical grounds, but because the pregnancy is unwanted, and raised concerns that reforms could introduce the possibility of sex-selective terminations. So we have the requests from the Scottish Council on Human Bioethics and the Evangelical Alliance to provide written evidence, but that, of course, depends on suggestions that there might be from within the committee in relation to how we might take forward the petition. Do colleagues have any suggestions? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder, in light of evidence that we have, if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders, on the basis that the Scottish Government have committed to reviewing the law on abortion to ensure that it is first and foremost a healthcare matter, rather than focused on criminal law, with intention of publishing potential proposals for reform before the end of the current Parliament session 2026. And can I remind the petitioner that if the Scottish Government doesn't do this, they're entitled to bring the petition back to the Petitions Committee?
And hopefully also be in a position to submit any views to the consultation on any legislation. But I think given that there is a legislative consultation coming forward in relation to this area, that probably is a sensible suggestion for the committee at this time. Are committee members minded to approve Mr. Torrance's suggestion? Yeah. We are. Thank you. That brings us to petition number 1991. To develop an educational resource on abortion. And this is the last of our continued petitions today, and it was lodged also by Gemma Clark. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to work with Education Scotland to develop a health-focused and stigma-challenging educational resource on abortion and to make it available to all secondary schools in Scotland. And we last considered this as well on the 22nd of February, where we agreed to write to stakeholder organisations. From whom? The Association of Directors of Education in Scotland, the General Teaching Council for Scotland, the Society for the Protection of Unborn Children, COSLA, the Scottish Catholic Education Service, and the petitioner have submitted responses. And copies of those responses were
submitted and circulated with our meeting papers this morning. Now, I draw members' attention to the responses from the COSLA and Association of the Directors of Education in Scotland, which note that materials linked to the ask of the petition are in fact already available, with work already taking place in schools to deal with the issues raised by the petition. COSLA also states that Curriculum for Excellence allows teachers, schools and local authorities to design a curriculum that fits their own local context, and the result of this being that there is no mechanism where all schools will be compelled to use any specific materials. And similarly, the response from the Scottish Catholic Education Service notes the availability of resources and advice for young people, also highlighting that schools are not the sole providers of education, and the close partnership between schools and the wider school community serves young people well in ensuring they have access to qualified expertise relating to the health, social, physical, spiritual and mental well-being. In view of the responses that we've received, therefore, do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder, in light of evidence that the committee has received, if we would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that education material linked to the ask of a petition already exists, including a relationship, sexual health and parenthood resource, which was developed by a partnership of local authorities and health boards with advice from Education Scotland and the Scottish Government, and also a flexible, affordable by Curriculum of Excellence means that there is no mechanism where all schools will be compelled to use any specific material.
Thank you. Colleagues minded to support? So I thank Gemma Clark for both the petitions, but in view of the response that we've received, I think the committee feels that appropriate work is being taken forward, and there's no further role that the committee can usefully perform. Agenda item two today is the consideration of new petitions. The first of those new petitions is petition number 2036 to write off student loan debts for paramedic students. And I'm happy to say to Rebecca Smith, who's lodged this petition, as I do to all those who might be tuning in to hear consideration of their petition, that ahead of the committee first considering the petition, we do seek the view of the Scottish Government and also the Scottish Parliament's independent research service, SPICE, in order that we can have an initially informed discussion rather than just postponing a discussion while we seek thereafter to get that information. So this petition, as I said, has been lodged by Rebecca Smith, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to write off Scottish loan debts incurred by paramedic science students before the current bursary was introduced. The SPICE briefing notes that student loan repayment conditions are set out in the Repayment of Student Loans Scotland Regulations 2000 and the Education Student Loans Repayment Regulations 2009, as thereafter amended. And it explains that under current legislation, student loan debt can only be cancelled 30 years after the loan holder became eligible to repay, or if the loan holder dies or becomes permanently unfit for work. The Scottish Government's current position is that students who commenced their paramedic science degree before the introduction of the bursary will still need to pay back any student loans they have received. The response states that there are no plans to write off previous student loans for this cohort of students. And that seems a fairly clear direction. Do colleagues have any suggestions to make?
Thank you, Convener.
It's a most unfortunate role, I feel you've
fallen
to you this morning, Mr. Torrance. I fear you're going to suggest we close the petition.
Yes, considering the stance that's been taken by the Scottish Government, I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has no plans to write off previous student loans for those who commenced as paramedic science degree before introduction of a bursary in 2021.
Well, fairly clear direction from the Scottish Government. They're not going to do it. So our colleagues minded to close the petition. And I thank Rebecca for bringing the petition forward. An important issue you raise, but the Scottish Government's position is clear, and therefore there is nothing further that the committee can usefully do to take forward the aims of your petition. The second and final petition this morning is petition number 2044 to recommit the £26 million pledged to colleges in the 23-24 budget. This has been lodged by Gillian Geddes, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to reinstate the £26 million pledged to colleges in the current year budget. The clerk's note provides an overview of the The clerk's note provides an overview of the education, children and young people's work on this issue as part of its pre-budget scrutiny. And the committee raised further and higher education funding as a key theme in its pre-budget scrutiny letter and continued to pursue the issues in subsequent evidence sessions. Last week, the committee issued its pre-budget scrutiny letter for the 24-25, which included college funding as one of its three main strands. The Minister for Higher Education, Further Education and Veterans' response to the petition states that he understands the disappointment on the need to take the £26 million saving, but that the college sector's core teaching funding allocation has been maintained. The submission states that the Scottish Government is committed to developing a new funding model for post-school education. In the light of the Minister's response, do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder, in the light of evidence before us and with another committee in the Parliament looking into the scrutiny of it, I wonder if we could consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Education, Children and Young People's Committee has undertaken scrutiny on the issue recently and will continue to do so as part of its pre-budget scrutiny for 2024-25.
So, are members inclined to support? We are. So, thank you very much to the petitioner. In view of the fact that one of our sister committees in Parliament is, in fact, taking forward the issues contained within the petition within its pre-budget scrutiny, we will close the petition. But thank you very much for drawing it to this committee and to Parliament's attention. That concludes our consideration of petitions today, and we will next meet on the 22nd of November. So I now close the meeting.